last section from chapter 6, which isn't a super long lesson today. Confidence intervals for you're going to need your table of values, your Z table of values you're using today, your purple packet. And the calculator will probably come in handy too. All right, confidence intervals for proportions. Okay, so the last two sections, we were doing confidence intervals for a mean, and whether we knew the standard deviation or not told us whether we used the Z or the T tables. We are no longer doing confidence intervals for means. We're going to be doing confidence intervals for proportions, which are like percentages. We're going to think about these as. So remember, we had a point estimate before, which was the sample mean, if we were calculating the population mean. So now our point estimate for P, P is going to represent the population proportion. You probably want to mark that somewhere on there because we're going to want to know the difference between the two. So P is population proportion. P hat is your sample proportion. Okay, so we call P hat the point estimate for that population proportion that we're trying to estimate. So the confidence interval that we eventually create is going to be an estimation for P. How we calculate P hat, we're calculating a percentage, so it's like a probability. The number of successes are X divided by N, the number in our sample. We also have a Q hat. If you guys remember P's and Q's from our binomial probabilities, Q is still the complement of P. So if P is, I don't know, 0.4, Q is going to be 0.6. All right. So first thing we're going to do is we have a survey and we're just going to find the point estimate for our population proportion. The survey here is 1,550 U.S. adults, 1,054 of them said that the social media website Facebook, or they would use the social media website Facebook. Find a point estimate for the population proportion. All right, so point estimate for the population proportion is P hat, number of successes over N, the total in the sample. So in this survey, a success would be someone that says they use the social media website Facebook, which would be 1,054 divided by 1,550, and we're going to get a decimal for that, 0.68, and that's all you have to do for our point estimate. Okay, good. All right. So then we need to be able to find a margin of error and a confidence interval. It's going to be very similar to what we did before. You can see a formula is going to be down here in a second. Before we do that, though, in order to find a confidence interval, we have something that we have to check or verify. Remember, before when we verified, either our population was normally distributed or our sample size was bigger than 30. Now it's a little different. We need both of these things to be true. N times P hat needs to be greater than or equal to 5, and N times Q hat needs to be greater than or equal to 5, and that ensures that we have a large enough sample to be able to do what we need to do. So actually, if we go back to that previous problem, if P hat is 0.68, what's Q hat? It's complement, 0.32. And then both of those we can multiply by N. And in this case is our sample size, which was 1550. So 0.68 times 1550 and 0.32 times 1550. 0.68 times 1550, actually know what that one's going to be. That's going to be my 1054. 0.32 times 1550 is going to be 496. As long as both of those are greater than or equal to 5, you have met your conditions, which they are, so it's a yes. Okay, and again, if you want to label these, this is NP hat and this is NQ hat. Okay, so instead of worrying about normally distributed certain sample size, we do this instead to check the sample size. Any questions there? All right, so now the formulas you have on the next slide are how we find the confidence interval and the margin of error. So margin of error, I'm going to start with, notice we're using those critical values of Z again. Most of them are going to be at the bottom of your Z chart already ready for you. And then under the square root, P hat, Q hat, all over N. So we know how to find all of those things. And then just like what we did before with the means, we're pretty much taking our P hat, our point estimate, adding and subtracting the margin of error, and then that creates the confidence interval. Most of the time when you see these, you're just going to round in two decimal places because they represent a percentage. Okay? So let's try one. The figure below is from a survey of 800 U.S. adults ages 18 to 29. We're going to construct a 99% confidence interval for the population proportion of 18 to 29-year-olds who get their news on television. Okay, so news on television is the part that we actually care about in this problem. P hat is the point estimate or the sample percentage in this case, which we already know. We do not have to calculate. They're telling us it's 0.27, 27%. We also have N, survey size, 800. If I have P hat, I can also get Q hat, its complement. 1 minus 0.27 gives me 0.73. And then before I go any further, I want to check my size here, my sample size. So NP hat and NQ hat. So 800 times 0.27 and 800 times 0.73. And let's see. 216 and 584. Okay, so both of those greater than or equal to 5, we're good. Okay, margin of error is a critical value of Z times the square root of P hat times Q hat over N. All right, so for the critical value of Z, you're going to need that from your chart. It is a 99% confidence interval, so that's the one that we're looking for at the bottom. Level of confidence, 0.99, and you guys should see it's 2.575. Square root, put all my other numbers in there, 0.27, 0.73, and it's 800. And then just be careful when you type this in. You might want to do it like in phases. Multiply the decimals together first, divide by 800, take the square root of that, and then multiply by 2.575. I get 0.0404, which if you were just discussing the margin of error, it's a 4.04% margin of error that we're getting. I give it two decimal places there. As far as the actual confidence interval goes, the original number that we had was a, what was it, 2.7? So P hat plus and minus E, I'm just going to do 0.27 plus and minus two decimal places, 0.04 for the margin of error. And then my confidence interval becomes 0.23 to 0.31. Okay, and then subtract that one. Okay. Any questions on those? Okay, so then if we wanted to interpret this, which you know a lot of those problems are going to ask for that, we would say we can be 99% confident, or remember the other way you could word that is you could say there is a 99% probability that the, and you want to say what you're estimating, the population proportion of 18 to 29-year-olds that use Facebook? No, this is the other one. What are we doing on this one? Oh, get their news on TV. Is between 23% and 31%. Okay, so we can be 99% confident, or there's 99 probability that the population proportion of 18 to 29 year olds that get their news on TV is between 23 and 31%. Questions getting margin of error, checking sample size, confidence interval. Nothing too crazy because we've done a lot of that already. Mm-hmm.
So, when you're checking for the Z score, 99% confidence.
Mm-hmm. So that one, you should just be able to see at the bottom. Put your paper over. The other side of the score chart. The bottom are the common ones. Now, let's say it was like, what numbers aren't on here? If it was like 98%, so if it's 98%, you have to imagine there's 98% in the middle, which means there's 1% on either side.
Okay.
So you then you look up 1%. So if I look up 0.01 on here, the closest I can get is a negative 2.33, and you just use the absolute value of that positive 2.33.
Okay.
So that's what you do if you don't have it. But most of the common ones you're going to see at the bottom here.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else? All right. So the last problem we're going to do together involves sample size. So if we're talking about minimum sample size needed, this is actually the error formula that we just had a few minutes ago. It's just rearranged a little bit. This is not on your paper, so if you want to just put it next to the error formula or in the margin somewhere. Again, it's the same thing. We just solved for n in the equation. Okay, so let's say we want to figure out what the minimum sample size needed for a certain margin of error. We use this. If you know p hat and q hat, you use them. If you do not know p hat and q hat, you make them both 0.5. You probably want to write that down next to the formula. If you do not have a point estimate, you do not know p hat or q hat, you place in this formula 0.5 for both. You just assume it's a 50-50 chance. Okay, but if we have them, obviously we want to use them. Okay, so let's do the one that's on your paper here. All right, you're running a political campaign and wish to estimate with 95% confidence the population proportion of registered voters who will vote for your candidate. Your estimate must be within 3% of the population proportion. Find the minimum sample size needed, one with no preliminary estimate, and two with a estimate of p hat is 0.3, and then compare your results. Okay, so we're doing this problem twice. So in the first part, we have no estimate for p hat. If we have no estimate for p hat, we use 0.5 for both of our values. Other information I can get from this is we have a 95% confidence level. From that, we can get the critical value of z off of our chart, which is 1.96. That's always positive. Our estimate must be within 3%, so that's our margin of error. Whatever we want it to be, within or close to, however they choose to word it. Okay, and we are solving for n. Formula is p hat, q hat, and then is it critical value divided by e squared? Yeah. Okay, and then we fill it in. 0.5. Times 0.5 times 1.96 over 0.03 squared. I get 1067.1. Do you remember when we did this with means? I think this might have been the video the day I wasn't here. When we did this with means, what we do with this number? If it's minimum needed. You always round up. Yep, because if we round down, we don't have the minimum required. So even if it's something like 0.1, we round up. The minimum sample size needed is 1,068. Okay. The only thing that changes then in the second part is now we know p hat, which is 0.31, which means we have q hat, its complement, 1 minus that, which is going to be 0.69. Everything else in your formula is going to be the same. All right, so this time it's going to be 0.31 times 0.69, 1.96 over 0.03. Square. Okay. 913.02. So 914. So you will usually see that you're going to have a smaller minimum needed if you know p hat, just because we have a little bit more information, so we don't need as large of a sample to figure out what we're trying to estimate. All right. Okay, so that's it for the lesson today. That's all of 6.3. Told you it was a short one. On the back of your paper, you have an exit ticket. What we're going to do with this one is I'm just going to have you guys work on it in class, and then tomorrow at the beginning of the period, we'll just check the answer, go over questions with it. So you can work on it now, or you can work on it at home. And then in class tomorrow, after we check the answers to this, you guys are going to have a Math Excel workday. Your 6.2 Math Excel is due, I think, tomorrow night. Let me double check that. 6.2 is due tomorrow night, and then this guy, 6.3, is due on Wednesday night. So you'll have a Math Excel workday to work on both of them tomorrow. And then Wednesday in class is going to be a open note individual quiz over 6.1 to 6.3. Okay, so that's what's happening for the next couple days. I'll do cell phone motto. The last half hour is yours. You can work on your exit ticket. You can work on your Math Excel. We'll go through those answers tomorrow. Cell phone motto winner is 16. Somebody won. Winner, winner. All right. Karma, because you answered my question for rounding up. There you go. Bonus opportunity, circuit training, just like we had the last couple chapters. This is the only one that goes with this test. It is over proportions, confidence intervals, due on Friday. It will be bonus for your test, bonus days, if you're interested.